My name is Jeff Gabriel. I am the CEO and co-founder of saw.com. In my tenure, I've had the opportunity to appraise tens of thousands of domain names, and I'm going to share with you today some of the metrics and things that I do to quickly and easily appraise a domain. I've had the opportunity to teach many different salespeople in our industry about appraising domain names. And one of the things I do when I'm teaching people is I create analogies. One of the analogies that I use a lot is one with real estate. And a domain appraisal is very similar to that. There's many metrics that a domain appraiser uses to put a value on a home. Well, that's very similar in domain names. Instead of square footage, we look at the extension it falls into. Instead of the location of the property, we might look at the industry that that domain name might target. And also when it comes to real estate, they talk about highest and best use for the domain name. And most importantly, above all, are comparable supporting sales of that property. Well, the same thing falls into that when it comes to domains. So some of the metrics that I'm going to look at and go through might be very obvious to some, but I might be pointing out the obvious. You might be saying, wow, I didn't think about that. And since appraising domains is not something that you have to go out and get a license for, there's a lot of different ways that people look at domain names in order to appraise them. But here's the ways that I do it, and I think it's worked for myself, my customers, and the companies that I've worked for over the years. The very first thing that I'm going to look at when I read a domain name or I see a domain name is I'm going to look at the extension. What is the domain extension? Well, you can look at the .com, the .net, the .org. We look at different ccTLDs, .co.uk, .de, .inc for gtlds, .xyz, or even .auto. And from there, what I try to do, which is the easiest thing to do, is compare whatever those extensions are to .com, which I consider the gold standard. So you try to make a proportionate value. So if the domain name is a .com, well, check, that's a positive. If it's the .net, well, I would probably try to appraise the domain in my mind that it's actually a .com because it's so much easier, because there's so much, there's such a wealth of information about past sales and other metrics about the .com, then try to proportionately value, base it on the .net values in the industry. So what does that mean? If I have a domain name that's cars.net to appraise, well, I'm going to pretend I'm appraising cars.com, and then I'm going to say to myself, okay, a .net is worth about 10% of the .com, and that's how I'm going to come to that value. But let's keep it easy. Let's focus on appraising a .com domain name. So after we get past the extension part, the next thing that we're going to look at is the industry that the domain name falls into. And one of the questions a lot of people ask me is they say, Jeff, the domain name that I'm looking to appraise falls into different industries. Well, my suggestion to you is really focus on the industry that has the highest demand and not look at the other industries that it might fall into. So for example, a very generic domain name that might fall into multiple industries would be card.com. You know, you can think of different uses for the name card, but the one for this purpose is, I would say, finance. That's because there's so many big players fighting for that term credit card out there. So the industry that falls into is very important. So some industries where it's most competitive are the obvious ones, like insurance, credit cards, travel. Anytime you turn on your TV, you're going to see advertisements having to do with those industries. Well, that tells me that there's a lot of demand for that particular domain. One of the things we look at next is the length of the domain name. One of those things is looking at, obviously, the number of characters. So let's look at one of the most perfect domains in the world, is yoga.com. It's only 4 letters. That is a very short domain. Now, if we start adding in Bikram yoga or hot yoga, those are all different types of yoga, but it starts to get longer. It starts to get harder to spell. It starts to get harder to remember. It gets harder to market. And for those that quickly walk past a billboard to read it, ingest it, and tell others about it. So the length has a lot to do with the value of the domain name. Now, what ties into the length of the domain name, it's kind of an easy thing to look at, but it's also in a kind of an opinion call, but it takes a lot of common sense to look at it. The question is, how memorable is it? And will it pass this thing called the radio test? So the question is, how will it sound on the radio? How will it be perceived to your listeners? And when we're talking about the radio test, we're also talking about putting it in a video, putting it on a business card, verbally telling somebody the name of your business, at a conference? Will they remember it? Will they go back and they spell it? Can a family or people who go and purchase your goods and services go out to dinner with their friends and say it and remember the name of the business and send you that business? From there, the next question is, if you're looking to become a worldwide brand, or the domain is going to become a worldwide brand, how universal is it in many different languages? Going back to my example about yoga.com, yoga is yoga in Spanish. Yoga is yoga in German. Yoga is yoga in Mandarin. So opening a brand that focuses on many different markets and languages, that domain name is as close to perfect as you're going to get. Looking at an opportunity like purchasingshoes.com, that's another short, perfect domain name. However, when you get into the Spanish-speaking market, that is zapatos. And if you look at it in German, it's a different word. And there's many different other ways to look at it. So it limits you, comparing that to yoga. And then tying into how the length and how universal it is, how easy is it to spell? The domain name, say, achieve.com would be a wonderful domain name, but will people mix up the E and the I? How does that sound to somebody who doesn't speak English as their first language? Are they going to have a hard time spelling it? There's a lot of people that come to me and ask me to do to appraise domain names, or ask me to help them acquire domain names, that instead of using the letter S on the end, they use the letter Z, and they pronounce it like it's plural. What does that do for your business with the radio test, with people making it memorable? That doesn't help. So one of the most absolute most important parts of the appraisal process is looking at comparable past sales that have happened in the market within a reasonable amount of time of the sale taking place. So looking at sales that happened in 2003 usually isn't very relevant. But one of the things that you have to think about is you can't just take the term that your domain name or anyone's domain name falls into, for that matter, and searching that term, and then anything that that term falls into is now a legitimate comparable sale. That is not the case. Pizza.com. Pizza is something that everybody loves to eat. When you say the word pizza, a lot of people smile and say, when are we going to get it? Okay? But if you say Jimmy's Pizza, that is not a relevant comparable sale. And if that sold for, say, $5,000, that is not a relevant comparable sale to the term pizza.com, which sold a few years ago for a few million dollars. Not comparable. If you'd like to learn more about appraising domain names or anything about domain names, you can go to saw.com and click on our resources button, and there's plenty of information there that you can learn about domains or anything having to do with it. If you'd like to make a suggestion as to what we could talk about next time, please go to our contact us section and say it, or maybe if you can even request a domain you'd like to be appraised that I can do live.